Well, welcome everyone to today's lecture. My name is Martin Fossil. I can see on the bottom of the screen on the webinar, the participant numbers growing very, very rapidly as I speak. So I'm just going to wait a moment until we reach a quorum. We've already got, wow, over 90 people. See if we can make a ton. Then we can crack on with the proceedings. 99, 100. Okay, I think in that case, we can get going. So if we can just move on to, I've got a few housekeeping announcements that I have to make before we get to the business in hand. As it says on the screen, the talk will last approximately 40 minutes, and then that'll be followed by Q&A. You, the audience, can type in questions using the Q&A function. I know by now we're all so used to this after a couple of years of this type of thing. So I'm sure most of you know how to do that. It's being recorded and it's going to be made available to the public, which is wonderful. So there will be a record of this. And closed captioning is available, and you click the CC button on your screen to enable the captions. Okay, so I just want to say a few words by way of introduction to today's lunchtime talk. I'm Martin Possel. I'm a senior research fellow here at the Paul Mellon Centre, and it's my pleasure to introduce today's speaker and chair the Q&A session that's going to follow. Timothy Brittain-Catlin is a fellow of Homerton College, and he leads the architecture apprenticeship course at the University of Cambridge. Tim's written extensively in books and articles on various aspects of architectural history, and his book publications include The English Parsonage in the Early 19th Century, published by Spire Books in 2008, and Bleak Houses, Disappointment and Failure in Architecture, published by the MIT Press in 2014. His most recent book, hold it up, is The Edwardians and Their Houses, published by London Humphreys in 2020. Which is, and those of you who haven't read it, it's a wonderful, sumptuous volume, as well as being a fascinating read. And this was published with support from the Paul Mellon Centre for Studies in British Art and the Society of Architectural Historians of Great Britain. And it was shortlisted for the 2021 William B. Berger Prize for British Art History. As Tim notes, during his research for this book, he's identified a series of key houses which illustrate how the attitudes of their architects and owners towards historic structures was quite different to the one which is prevalent today. And in his talk, he's going to focus on three key buildings: Lord Avebury's Kingsgate Castle in Kent, Lord Carrington's Dawes Hill at Wickham Abbey, Buckinghamshire, and W.D. Caro's family home at the Van in Surrey, none of which I'm ashamed to say I knew about before Tim's talk. And he's going to identify in the course of these case studies his new research areas that emerged during the research for this book. So time's moving on. So without further ado, I'd like to hand over to Tim to talk to us about the making and remaking of the Edwardian House. Over to you, Tim.
Martin, thank you very much indeed for that generous introduction. And in fact, the first thing I'd like to say, and I'm going to share the screen as I say this, is that I would like to thank the Paul Mellon Centre for British Art for the extraordinary contribution they made to this book by supporting the photography by Robin Forster. I hope that you'll see over the next hour some wonderful photographs which were taken especially for this book, and it reinforces the fact that first-rate photography makes an enormous contribution to the primary research of historic buildings. So, I'm sure that you'll appreciate that as we go through it. I'm going to start with the first of those three buildings that that Martin mentioned. Now, this book as a whole covered how the Edwardian liberals mostly built themselves and other people houses at all scales. So they're building from the scale of the country house. Some of these people were cabinet members who needed a new house in London. They needed a new house within reach of London. They needed a new house by the golf course in many cases. This is one of those, by the way. And at the same time, they were passing legislation which enabled and encouraged the building of high quality houses outside London in Gidea Park, in garden cities, in what were called town planning schemes and so on. The Edwardian liberals are enormously involved and engaged with encouraging house building, and it's a period of a very high standard of discussion in the press, in Country Life in particular, but also in other professional magazines about what houses should look like, why they look the way they do. And I often think that, in a sense, by the end of the Edwardian period, we know how to design a house that works, where to put the windows, where to put the bed, where to position the door and the fireplace and so on. We know how to do that. And you could almost go as far as saying that all house design since about 1914 has been experimentation, because the basic work has been done. Now, what this talk is about one particular theme that surprised me as it emerged through the book. And these three buildings are the buildings through which I discovered something that I had no idea about before I started. We're all familiar, I think, to some extent, with the arts and crafts history of Edwardian England, and to some extent with the new country house history. The great theme that I discovered is what is happening when people are working with old buildings. What are they doing? And how was it that there was such a developed culture of working with existing buildings? And I think that this is today also an enormously important subject, because of course we're all encouraged, architects are encouraged now increasingly to remodel existing buildings rather than use superfluous resources in building new ones. It seems to me to be something that is not only very current, but also something which is very rich and very interesting and has a lot to contribute. And I'm glad to say visually, extremely beautiful. Now, this was my starting point. This is Kingsgate Castle. This was designed from 1900 for Lord Avebury, that's to say Sir John Lubbock, as he then was. He took the title of Lord Avebury at the beginning of the new century. He wanted a new house to go with it. He found himself on the Thanet coast between Broadstairs and Margate. He was staying at Holland House with the artist Luke Fields, who was a friend of his. He saw this Georgian folly on the opposite cliff. It was at the time a kind of ramshackle house. It had had a roof added in the 19th century and various rooms and so on. And he decides to turn this into his principal residence. And he goes to an architect called W.H. Remain Walker. Most of Remain Walker's houses have become very luxurious hotels, which tells us a bit, I think, about the kind of milieu he worked in. And Remain Walker converted the old building, the old Folly building, it had been stables for Lord Holland, converted it into a luxurious house. If you look at the tower there, we're coming in through the central entrance arch. Straight ahead is a tower, a round tower, which more or less takes the form of the original Folly Tower. And you can see there in the flint, the old flint and the new flint put together. It's a moment of looking at this, we'll see that Remain Walker pretty much rebuilt the whole thing, but he kept a great deal of the quality and the feeling of the old place. Now, I always found this an intriguing building. We had a holiday flat in it when I was a child in the 1960s. It had been a hotel. And after the Second World War, when no one had perhaps the cash for big hotels, each pair of hotel suites was turned into a very small and very cheap holiday flat. And this is where we used to go. And this building, my brother says to me, this building made an enormous impression on me when I was very young. And I think that must be true, because here I am 50 something years later, still talking about it and thinking about it. But I wanted to find out more about it. And the central question here, I would say, was this: what people tended to say about buildings like Kingsgate Castle is that they were in some way fake, that it was a sham castle, that it wasn't a real castle, that it was a kind of mock-up, and therefore was not a building to be taken seriously. And this approach troubled me, because there was no reason to suppose that a high-minded person such as Lord Avebury would have done anything fake in his life. He was a scientist, he was an archaeologist, he was a political reformer, he was amongst the early initiators of the ancient monuments protection. He was, as we all know, he was the instigator of the public holidays. There was no reason to suppose that Lord Avebury, although he had, I think, a bright and a warm personality, would have done something fake necessarily for his house. So I wondered where this came from, and that led me into the following two houses. The first clue came about through reading up the biographies one by one as a very preliminary step of all the members of Asquith's government, simply in the Dictionary of National Biography. And there I found something fascinating in the entry on Lord Carrington, Earl Carrington, written by Andrew Adonis. who before he became a politician was a specialist on late Victorian Liberal Party land reform. And what the biography says of Lord Carrington was that at a certain point in life, he decided to convert a farmhouse on his estate in High Wycombe into a residence for himself. Now, what you're looking at here is an early 20th century photograph of the house known as Dawes Hill, which was a farmhouse on the estate to the south of where Wycombe Abbey House itself is. What there was here in 1897, when Lord Carrington began this process, was on the right-hand side. You can see it's the blob of white towards the right-hand side of the building. There was an old farmhouse building. And then the buildings in the foreground, whilst they didn't look as they do today, was a collection of farmyard buildings. There was a carving shed, there was a slaughterhouse, there was a barn and so on. And these were a fairly ramshackle courtyard of single story, some of them quite tall buildings. What has happened was this: Lord Carrington, a very interesting character. He was deeply involved in land reform, central plank of the Liberal Party from the 1880s onwards at least. And he was very astute on anything to do with land. It's interesting that as a person, he moved in the highest classes of the nobility. He was a personal friend of Edward VII. He was Lord Great Chamberlain to Queen Victoria, in fact. He spent his summers up in Balmoral. And he was very astute on land ownership. He was interested in the Land Nationalisation Society. He became active as a member of Asquith's government in the creation of secure small holdings, mostly for agricultural workers. He gave a great deal of land and money to the town of High Wycombe. And in the middle of all this process, he moved out of Wycombe Abbey, which he saw as being a huge sink of money for his son. Perhaps he knew also the inheritance taxes that were going to come as part of Lloyd George's budget. And he'd moved in with his family to that farmhouse on the right-hand side. Well, they decided to choose a new site for a new house, but the family loved the farmhouse. They found it cozy, comfortable, warm, and they decided to stay there. So Carrington at this point decides that if his daughters, his wife, his young son are happy in the farmhouse, then that's where he'll stay. And he converts these buildings into a residence. Now, one thing that's very striking about Lord Carrington is that although he was so active in building and in anything to do with building and land tenure, at the same time, he doesn't seem to have had any interest in architectural quality at all. In fact, it's rather a shame, I think, that the large sites that he granted, the new road that he built in the center of High Wycombe, have got, on the whole, very dull buildings on it. And he made no exception in his own case. In fact, he at the time, he was a London County Councillor for a ward in St. Pancras, and he appears to have gone to the local district surveyors, named Mr. Lease, and asked him to carry out the task of converting this farmhouse into a series of rooms that befitted a member of the government and a friend of royalty. Edward VII and Queen Alexandra came to visit this house, for example. Now, I'll take you through a few photographs of how it is today. It's some considerable tribute to the photographer Robin Forster that you wouldn't know it, but this photograph was taken in the heavy pouring rain. That might account for why the colour is a little washed out, but it's nice and clear and you can see what it is. And you can also see that it is, it's the fact that it's not particularly attractive or striking as a design of a building is in fact the thing that makes it interesting, I think, because all the emphasis of the design is on accommodating the old buildings and not on making a new set piece. There's the farmhouse on the right. On the far right is a much later building by Forsyth and Moore from the period when the Wycombe Abbey Girls' School, to whom Lord Carrington had sold the house, they took it over and they turned it into a dormitory building. And that's the right-hand bit, which is actually a very fine building, I think. Let me take you around and show you some of the areas. So here is the entranceway, the Carrington coat of arms around it. And the old set of farm buildings runs from that front left-hand corner, you can see there, back towards the rear of the site. And there are some clues about the original use of the buildings in some place. There is a view from the front. It's not perhaps what you'd expect of the residence of a cabinet minister. And I have to say he had other places. He had a house in Whitehall Court and he had another castle in Wales. So it's not as if he was here all the time, but he spent a lot of time here. He liked being here. He liked the fact that it reminded him of how when he himself had been a child, he used to go and play in the farmyard, and he turned one of the old farmyard sheds into his study. So there is a little bit of remaking his early life, I suppose, into his later successful political life. Here are a couple of photographs of the interior as it looked when the Carringtons lived there. What you're looking at here is the corridor that crosses from left to right in front of that entrance porchway. And this is the junction of the new corridor with the old range of farm buildings. And here then is that long side that runs off. On the left-hand side, you see the castellated bit. That is probably the work of, that's probably the work of James Wyatt, who was at Wickham Abbey long before, of course. And here you can see the old farm buildings with extra bits added to them. Looking back up at the farm building, if you see that clock tower there with the cupola above it, follow that roof, the bottom left of it along, you can see the original brickwork of the old barn below it. There it is in close up. So you can see the different patched up pieces of brick. They're also reusing bits of brick from the farm buildings and mixing them up with the new ones. So you get something very uncertain age, I think. Now, that's a new wing that Mr. Lees built. He built a second new wing as well. It wasn't small, this house. This is on the far side of the corridor. But this is what Mr. Lees does when he's left to his own devices with a new project. It's facing the rebuilt part. And this, I think, is probably the most extraordinary view of all. This is inside the old barn. So this is below that clock tower and cupola. There's no sign of it from underneath. Up on the ceiling there, you can see panels by Angelica Kaufman, which were taken from another of the various Carrington family residences. And this is the inside of the old barn after it has been fitted up. That big bay window that you will have seen on some of the other photographs, that's just off to the left. That's the source of the lighting here. You also see a very fine fireplace on the right-hand side. All this survives, not the furniture and not the Kaufman panels, but the room survives absolutely as it was. What's happened in this room is that panelling was taken from a different Carrington house and fitted in to a new room, which had been one of the old agricultural buildings, with other bits to fill up the gaps. That bit between the mantelpiece and the fire opening itself seems to me to be a filled up gap. And there are other bits too, where the timber is slightly too good to be, or too sharp, I suppose, to be part of the original work. So it's a great collection of stuff being put inside the building here. Now, where does this come from? The most, I think, the thing that I learned from this is that there is actually a continuing developing story from the 1850s right through to the 1930s of the reuse of buildings and the reuse of building components and the shifting around of the interiors of one building to another, continuously going on and enormously prominent in the press. Which is much overlooked in histories of the period. It's rather in the nature of architectural history that it tends to concentrate on things that are completely new on the one hand, and on the other hand, they concentrate also on the fact that a building has achieved novelty in some way or another. It's the way in which most histories are built up. But you can look at this from a different way and see a continuing development of the idea of mixing the old and the new. And it only works if the architect has got a tremendous detailed knowledge of how the old building fitted together. So this is where the story changes slightly. What you're looking at here is a farm called South Park, just to the southwest of Penshurst in West Kent, and it was designed, and I'm going to go back to what exactly I mean by that word, it was designed by George Devey round about 1850. So first of all, remember that Pugin is still alive. Devey at this time was doing something that was really quite remarkable, and I don't think that it had really happened before in quite the same way. He worked on this farmyard. He also worked on a little group of cottages called Leicester Square, which sit at the entrance to the churchyard in Penshurst. They're extremely picturesque. They are slightly too good to be true. But on the other hand, what they are is enormously authentically remade and remodeled by Devey in such a way that you cannot tell what is old, or what is new? And that's the most important part, I think. Now, I want to stress that particular element, and I'm going to return to it, because one thing we know about the Society for the Protection of Ancient Buildings and its long-lasting influence is that it became an absolute principle of SBAB that retaining the old material of a building was something that was non-negotiable. Anybody who was adding to, restoring to, or anyone who's been doing this in recent years of an old building has generally speaking had to accept the fact that the old part cannot really be changed and that any new work must be completely distinct. But what's important to remember is that nobody thought this at the end of the 19th century beyond the activists of SBAB themselves. So what Devi is doing to these cottages around here is that he's going into, he has such a knowledge of how these old buildings are held together that he can, as it were, go into their past and remake it. He can remodel the buildings. Now, you will say architects have always added to old cottages. They've always modernized them. They've always put in new rooms. They weren't waiting until George Devey in 1850 before they started to upgrade houses and so on. And of course, that's true. But if they were an architect, as opposed to perhaps a local builder, what they generally did was make the new work completely distinct. We can all think of examples where a completely distinct addition or was added. It might have been a distinct facade where a Tudor house was refronted by in the 18th century, for example. But Devi isn't doing any of this. With Devi, the concept of history, as it were, is completely disappeared. He's going in and working at it subtly in a lot of different ways. And what this requires is enormous interest in the precise details of the way in which materials join together. I said that this is 1850 and Pugin is still alive. We know that if Pugin had been working on these Penshurst cottages, they would have looked to some extent like Pugin houses, whereas they don't look like Devi houses necessarily. Devi was the ultimate, the ultimate pursuit of perfection in building details. There is a famous, all the best stories about him are told by Voisey, who worked for him, and Voisey tells the best story of all, which is that a builder once called Devi up onto the roof of a building that he was working on and had to admit to a kind of bodge up between the flashing and the tiles or something of that sort. But he said to the architect, Mr. Devi, don't worry about it. Nobody will see it. It's up here on the roof. And Devi famously replied, I should be ashamed for the birds to see it. So this is the level of precision that Devi is interested in. Now, there is a process that runs from the publication of Devi's work and the discovery of Devi's work, because he died at a relatively young age, up to the Edwardian period. And the great step forward, I think, is the establishment of country life in the 1890s as the in Mark Giroir's words, as the culmination of Devi's way of thinking about buildings, the precise assembly of objects in a particular way. It's very important also to remember country life. And for many of you today, we're well aware of the fact that country life has throughout the whole of its history published very often the best up-to-date historical accurate research about houses. That's something I think that we can probably all agree on is extremely high quality. And it was doing it right from the start. But what country life was also doing, and the professional press was not for quite a while, was it was publishing regular articles on doors, on windows, on chimneys, surveyed from different parts of the country and discussed and compared, so that an architect at the very end of the 1890s, the beginning of the 1900s, had, if they wanted, particular access directly to the historic ways of building in a way that they really didn't before. This coincides also with an explosion of books by Batsford and by others. And the emphasis here is not so much on the perfection of a complete new building, it's much more on what happens when you put different junctions of buildings together. Now, I've stayed on this image of South Park for a while because I think that the Devi story is important. It's very rewarding. Devi's buildings sometimes suffer from looking a bit like a great mixture of building materials all jammed together without any overall coherence. But I think to some extent, one might even slightly say that it is the point. Now, on the subject of country life. Before I go on to talk about the third of the great houses today, let me say a little bit more about country life. Country life had two of the greatest writers, I think, on domestic architecture that we've ever had. In fact, I think it's fair to say that Lawrence Weaver, who was writing for Country Life from 1909 onwards, was probably the first modern architecture critic, the first architecture critic in the modern sense of the word. And by that, I mean, you need only to compare the way in which Weaver writes about buildings with the way in which, say, Ruskin had written about buildings to see a world of difference. Weaver has a very broad, informed, practical view about buildings and how they're put together. And one can find really remarkable occurrences of this in the pages of Country Life. For example, famous houses by Edgar Wood with the flat roofs and so on. They appear in Country Life before they appear in the Architectural Review, for example. So he's open-minded, he's logical, and he's very analytical in his thinking. And he came as the successor to H. Avery Tipping, who was an extremely, I think, extremely talented and perceptive writer on houses and on buildings, really, of all kinds. It's an extraordinary combination. And what Tipping and Weaver particularly liked, Tipping, I think, in particular, what they really liked was houses that had a great jumble of architectural periods together under one roof. They liked South Wraxall Manor, for example, because it has this combination of the medieval, and then it has a pair of 17th century columns, Tuscan style columns on one wing of it. They liked this clash, and they were, I think, they were right to like it, because it's a very difficult thing to do, to resolve the details from different historical buildings within one single house or within one single room. Philip Webb puts a fireplace that looks like it might be by Vanbrugh in what is otherwise a mostly Tudor room. It's very difficult to get that right. It's a reason why architects in particular revered Webb, because Webb could do it. In fact, the 17th century in general was particularly popular during the Edwardian period because of the way in which it runs from Tudor Jacobean right up to the William and Mary, the William and Mary style. So for those reasons, it gives them a lovely collection of difficult things to put together. It's often said that Lutyens was unusual in putting classical interiors inside Tudor houses, but in fact, it wasn't unusual at all. Almost everybody was doing it. He was doing it better, and he did it perhaps more photogenically, but nevertheless, it becomes enormously common. Now, here we are on house number three, and house number three is called Van. It may be familiar to you as architecture historians. It would also be familiar to you if you saw the BBC's version of E.M. Forster's novel Howard's End, where this stood in for Howard's End. And it was a brilliant piece of location casting, because this house, the way it looks now, was designed in 1907, which is roughly speaking when Forster was writing Howard's End. And you wouldn't think so to look at it. And what you're looking at is a combination not only Edwardian work, but with the remnants of the medieval and 17th century buildings on the site. But you're looking at a tremendous mixture of things brought from different places at different times to arrive at a house which, because of the complexity of the combination in it, could really only be an Edwardian house. I've heard it said about these houses. I mentioned that people criticize buildings like Kingsgate Castle as being sham, as being inauthentic, and that this too might be one of those inauthentic houses because it's made up of bits and pieces. But I take the opposite view. I would say that this is a building which is enormously real, because the individual elements of it are specifically doing a particular job which the architect wanted to do. Let me take you through some of the images of Van. By 1907, Caro is a well-established and serious architect, very substantial buildings. The Church Commissioner's building on Millbank is perhaps the outstanding example. That's where he had his office, and then he came down here. He had, for picturesque reasons, he got the post office to install a letterbox at his entrance gate here. The post office was reluctant to put a letterbox down a otherwise completely deserted, windy country lane in the middle of nowhere. They said they would only do it if there were 2,000 letters deposited in it, I think a month. So what Caro did was he brought all his office post from Westminster, and he posted it in the letterbox outside his house in order to keep the post office happy. So a lot of things going on in Caro's life at the time, I think. He built this for his family. It's a combination of a number of different things which are brought, different objects which are brought from different houses in order to make something that is of its period in a completely unspab-like way. The brickwork here on the far left-hand side was there before Caro arrived. Some of the timber framing, but by no means all of it, that you can see on the upper floor on the left-hand wing was there, but very little else was, in fact. You can see that the chimneys are new. Here's another view of the house from further along, and you can see a bit of 18th century brickwork on the left-hand side, but windows which are definitely 1907, and the tile hanging and the modern brickwork of the chimney above it, and a bit of mixture of the brickwork too, bringing it from different places. It's a wonderful thing about this house that the proportions seem to change depending on precisely the angle that you're coming at. This is the garden on the opposite side from that long view that you saw. So there is the existing brickwork on the right-hand side, and a new piece of the house on the left-hand side with timber framing of different bits and pieces. Here is the front door. The door is made specially for the house, but many of the items and some of the other doors, which I'll show you, are in fact made up from other doors from other places. Here is the corner at the junction of what was mostly a medieval house with what was certainly a completely new piece of house. And there is an 18th century water tank, as you can see, with some very fine decoration on it. And what Caro is doing here is what you'd expect from someone who is following Divi's example, which is you take the best possible thing from another house or from another place, and because of the quality of the thing, regardless of its age or regardless of how well it fits in historically with the building, you put it in it because the architectural quality is the combination of these different details. Now here is a plan of the house, and everything that is black is new. So, and you can see that only the bit on the right-hand side is the grey part that was there before, and even then that was very greatly changed. Here's the entrance hall. It's got a fireplace surround brought in from elsewhere. The stairs are mostly new. You can see a door. You can see the other side of that door that I showed you from the outside. On the far side, the house belongs still to the Caro family, so it's had four generations of architect living in it. And Oliver Caro is a great source of wisdom on this house and tells many interesting stories about it. And one of the best stories of all, I think, is that there was, on the upper level of the medieval house, there was a timber beam that was too low for a modern corridor. So what Caro did was he chopped it off, and he reconnected the roof truss above the level of the new ceiling height using a new iron fixing out of sight above the ceiling. And then where the old beam had been, he put a much more slender one that allowed someone to walk under it to represent the old beam that had been there before. Now, this, of course, was the greatest horror of horrors to Spab. Because in Spab's view, not only had he cut up the old building, but he'd also put in something that looked like it was a piece of the old building, but in fact wasn't. What Caro had put in was representative of what there had been before, rather than the actual thing. And that particular conflict, I think, is an extremely interesting example of precisely where Caro and the attitude of architects like him is different from that of the general view of historical building and fabric that we're now so familiar with that we've perhaps forgotten that it was ever controversial. There's some fantastic metalwork in this house. There is a ceiling that Caro brought in from the house, different house altogether, from 17th century house in Wales that's being demolished. And as we all know, huge numbers of houses were developed after First World War. This was put in, I think, before the First World War, but Caro went on moving things around. He moved things from place to place within the house as well as bringing them in from outside. So there isn't really anything, I suppose you could say, that was originally anything. Everything you see is part of the building that he created. There is, now it's a very fine door, I think, in a quite a different style really that's brought in, but that does show a nice example of the point I was making before about resolving different types of architecture so that they still look right, even though they're from a different period. If they're well enough detailed and well enough absorbed into the old building, they can look exactly right. There is, on the right-hand side, you can see a piece of timber that is in place of an old one that needed to be removed, which very probably followed the line that you can see on the left-hand side, actually, to the left-hand side of the window. Is the upper floor at Van. And here is a view towards the barn. We weren't able to photograph the barn, but the barn is part of its history. Now, the barn at Van is converted into, I think you would call it, a party room. It had a billiard table in it. It's not actually the first barn conversion in the modern sense. The modern sense of barn conversion, I would say, means a building which is stripped down to its, basically to its original form, and it becomes kind of good taste residence with minimal amount of furniture from heels in it, a few rugs and a few antiques and so on. Now, the first person to do that was, of all people, the wife of the Prime Minister, Margot Asquith. She did it at her house in Sutton Courtenay, which was then in Berkshire, now in Oxfordshire. And that's where she used to go. She called it her studio. And that really is the first barn conversion. And that's about 1912. Mrs. Asquith wrote absolutely voluminous volumes of, that's a bit of a tautology, isn't it? She wrote large amounts of self-justifying autobiography, but nowhere does she say why she took this extraordinary step. And it almost certainly came about through a suggestion of her architect, Walter Cave. Walter Cave does not appear at all in Mrs. Asquith's diaries, although she had an awful lot to do with him. He built her a new house as well. And that's a sign that architects were very much socially, I think, below the radar of people of the status of the Prime Minister's wife. So whereas on the one hand, you get this wonderful idea, which I think is also forms a nice part of Liberal Party ideology at the time about houses belonging to the land and so on, being made from the land, the timber on the land and so on, rather than imposed on them in the way that a Palladian house might be, or a Gothic Revival house might be, or a grand Baroque house might be. So on the one hand, it's her barn conversion is a sign that the Liberals are people who belong to the place and the land belongs to its people and all the rest of it. On the other hand, she's much too grand to talk to the architect. And in fact, Romaine Walker doesn't appear in the visitor's book for Kingsgate Castle until Lord Avebury has died. Only then does he come in through the front door. He comes in, interestingly enough, with a very young Harry Goodhart Rendell who's come to snoop around with him. But let's return to Van. This is the corridor that leads up to the barn itself. And Oliver Carey told me that in the barn, and I think converting the barn into a big party room was actually an afterthought, because it hardly features in the Carrow office survey drawings of the building. I think he would have taken it more seriously earlier on if he'd known what it was he was going to do with it. But what he did was he moved the timbers around. So a joist becomes a wall plate. He rotated the piers of the posts inside, because on one side they'd been abraded by the cattle. So he rotated them and so on. I'm very grateful to Oliver for all the comments he made about the house, because there's nothing like living in one to get to know it extremely well. So there is an awful lot going on here, and none of it is quite as it seems. Now, with that, I'd like to return to and to conclude with a bit more about Kingsgate Castle. This is the entrance gateway. Bits of it are part of the 18th century folly. It was all remade by Romaine Walker for Lord Avebury. The wing on the left actually wasn't added till the 1930s. This became a very smart hotel from the 1920s onwards. It's where Hollywood film stars would come. Laurence Olivier would come here, Constance Cummings and so on. There's a list of visitors. It had everything that they needed. It had the croquet lawn. It had the Moorish style squash courts next door and so on. It was a very exclusive place at the time. One of the things I never really worked out about it is how the food got from the service entrance to the right to the dining room on the left, and there must have been a tunnel. This is very easily tunnelable chalk in this area, so I guess that's what there was. Romaine Walker did do tricks to hide roots like this at Rhinefield, a big house in the New Forest, which is now one of the grand hotels I was referring to earlier. At Rhinefield, where the kitchen is, as often the case, some distance away from the dining room, what Romaine Walker did was he built a kind of trench, a sort of ha-ha, that the staff could walk along in front of the house without being seen. And I think there must have been a tunnel here of some sort. So it's a sophisticated and it's a modern Edwardian house. And it's got in it, and you can see in this photograph, you can see in it some of these strata, as it were, of older Georgian period flints. Now, one of Avery's interests was Romano-British history. Just down the coast from Kingsgate Castle, there are the remains of Richborough Castle, very late Romano-British construction, something about 400, I think, AD. And he knew that area very well. And he also tended to look, he was the kind of scientist who liked to record the fact that he saw patterns and things. He was very interested in strata and stone and so on. He spent a lot of time looking at the chalk cliffs around Kingsgate to see the patterns of the flint in it. And I think that he saw this castle as being, with its different strata of new and old flint, as having something of the quality of those old ruins that he liked so much. One thing that's very striking about this castle is that when he built it, and the current Lord Avery was kind enough to show me photographs that his ancestor had very wisely had taken professionally when the house was finished, it didn't have a Victorian garden. It's finished about, well, it's they're living in it by about 1903, 1904. It didn't have any kind of formal garden. It had no Victorian garden. It had no Edwardian garden either. It just sat on the grass, and it looked like a bit like an archaeological site. And I think for Lord Avery himself, that was a great attraction to it. And it wasn't a fake piece of ruins, as it were. It was a new creation of something that did have something in common with the qualities of the old building. There's also something else interesting that's going on here, and that's a slightly childlike quality to some of these places. It's something that recurs a lot in Edwardian houses of different scales. There are a lot of new castles going up. We used to read as children the stories by E. Nesbitt, and there's one called Harding's Luck, which was our favorite. There's another one called The House of Arden, and the characters in these stories come together towards the end. And they are looking for the remains of some old ancestral castle so that they can remake it. And of course, we thought as children in the 1960s that this was a kind of a romantic fantasy, that the castle might suddenly spring back into life again. But I think it's important to remember that during the period when E. Nesbitt was writing, and she certainly knew about this, new castles were actually springing up. It was quite an accurate description of what was going on. So these houses also have, for all their realism, for all the way in which little bits of the puzzle are fitted together with the expertise of architects who knew so precisely the different elements and of building construction from different periods, for all of that, there is on the other hand a slightly magical quality to it. I sometimes think that one of the reasons why country life had the impact that it had was that country life was, on the one hand, a very hard-headed publication. It was aimed at landowners, or at people wanting to commission new buildings. So it was aimed at the clients, as it were. They were very supportive of Lord Carrington's land tenure reforms, and they would fill pages with calculations about the rents and so on for country landowners, about what would happen, how much you should borrow in order to let out, how much space with what kind of rental and so on. They were actually very hard-headed, but at the same time they presented these amazing romantic images, not so much of the houses, because I tend to think the buildings are not particularly romantic, really. They're done by professional people in offices, so romantic is not really quite what they are, but a lot of other romantic imagery, people's favorite pet, their favorite dog, children splashing through a stream, that kind of thing. And this was a very one of them was a very good way of selling the other. And I suppose what I'd say in conclusion is that I discovered in the course of doing this research, that these two themes run together, and between them, perhaps from their extremes, when they meet in the middle, they produce some of the finest houses that we've ever seen. I think, Martin, I'll conclude at that point. Oh, that's it. Hello. Now I'm hearing
you. Yeah. Oh, yeah, back together. Thank you very much indeed, Terry. That was wonderful. And you've uncovered such, not just new research, but new perspectives and expectations about what Edwardian architecture is. And this deeply significant, you talk about in the introduction of your book, this cultural and political vein, and this strong connection with liberal culture and liberal ideology and so on. We've got one question in the box, so please do use the Q&A function. There are still 130 people here, so I'm sure some of you would like to ask Tim questions yourself. I've got a few, I've got a sort of, it's partly observation, partly question, Tim, and it comes out of Dawes Hill. It's not a house I knew, and as you yourself, it's not the most exciting piece of architecture to look at. In fact, your book is not about, and as you say, it's not about country houses per se, as in the tradition of the English country house. It's about Edwardian houses, and they're all very, very varied. And I was struck at Dawes Hill by the contrast between this almost municipal looking exterior and this fantastically grand interior with pilasters and columns and pediments and oil paintings, which felt very Georgian. And I thought, well, this is interesting. Georgian architecture is anathema, and yet here's you go into the house and you roll up, go through the front door, and you go, my God, this is not a farmhouse at all. So that's a specific observation, but it's also how these houses seek to blend in with the surroundings. They're not seeking to impress. They're kind of under the radar. They're vernacular. And to what extent was that, and you've talked about in your book, a political statement, as in not to attract attention or envy or reinforce hierarchy and status, that they were, even though they were private, they were democratic and not aristocratic?
I think there is a very strong theme in Liberal Party builders of different sorts, so with politicians to clients, of creating an architecture which is, as you'd correctly put it, Martin, not Georgian. One staggering discovery, I'd say staggering for me, there'll be many people who did know about these things, is that the area around Smith Square in London, south of Westminster Abbey, which was mostly a mixture of Georgian slums with Victorian works of various kinds and some commercial buildings. There was a gasworks, there was a Victorian chamber of lawyers' offices, but it was mostly Georgian slums around there, was completely rebuilt to look the way it does today on the initiative of the London County Council, which was run by the Progressive Party. So all that area around there, which filled up with Queen Anne period houses, the best ones are by Horace Field. There are two really fine ones in Cowley Street by Horace Field. It was built to recreate a kind of Stuart architecture and a Stuart enclave in London that had in fact never existed at the time. This was extraordinary to me. I thought I knew that area well. It turned out I didn't. So there is definitely a feeling, and it tends to be more, it's not only hinted at, it's sometimes said explicitly, that what liberals were doing was that they were producing a kind of architecture which was very different to what they saw as being the Tory century of the big landowners and their big houses. We're probably familiar with the rude things that Victorian architects had to say about Palladian houses and about 18th century houses in general, very good on invective on houses of those periods. But in fact, even the country life people whose turn of phrase was often enormously subtle and very accurate, even those people were sometimes quite brutal, describing, for example, 18th or early 19th, particularly didn't like early 19th century classical architecture, and they would describe it as a crime, for example, when Robert Smirk pulls down a Tudor building and replaces it with a block of his own. A crime is what Weaver says about it, and Weaver is a very gently spoken person. The story of Gidea Park, tells you an awful lot about attitudes. Gideo Park was a garden suburb in Romford. You can go to it on the Elizabeth Line if it ever opens. And it is the initiative of Liberal Party activists. One was an MP and the other two became MPs. And what they built there was a little collection of houses, almost all of them in variations of the Tudor style. There was a great deal of interest at the time, this is 1910, about how small can you build a good quality house. These are small houses, cheap houses, very high quality houses for all that. They were £300 and £500, 375, I think, and £500. In the middle of the site, when it was developed, was a very large 18th century house built on the site of a medieval one. When the visitor's guide to Gideo Park was produced, what is astonishing about it is that it pretends, in effect, that the big 18th century house was not actually there. The guidebook talks about the glories of the Tudor and medieval house that had been there, and anyone who read the catalogue would think that it was still there. But the enormous big white block that actually was there was completely ignored, as if it was a brutalist, you know, car park in the centre of Bath. It's quite astonishing. So there is that. And I think there is a feeling, and it develops out of the 3 acres and a cow movement of late Victorian England. There is a feeling that an Englishman's house should look like the Englishman built it himself. These Tudor houses that are made from local materials, you can kind of imagine that the person who lives there actually built it themselves, in a way that the person in the Baroque house, the person in the Gothic Revival house, would not have been able to build the house themselves. There is something of that going on, and it's on the edge of being explicit. And there's occasionally a flash that indicates that it's true. And there is Mrs. Asquith, whom some saw maybe as a kind of Marie Antoinette figure, living in her perfect Tudor barn, which she has had restored to look even more like perfect Tudor barn. It's incidentally recently been extended very well in much the same style. So there is a consistent history here, and there's a very strong connection, I think, between liberals and the architecture that bookends the hated 18th century.
Yeah, thank you so much. That was an excellent response. And following up, I've got about half a dozen questions here. Some are very specific, and I might leave those for a moment because they're things that you can answer in a moment. But I'm going to turn to Helen Wild. She says, thank you for your brilliant lecture, Tim. You've shed new light on the relationship to the past in this crucial period. I'm interested that your book focuses on liberal politicians and individuals. Following on from Martin's question, were there elements of the Tudor and Stuart period that you think appealed to these people for political and ideological reasons?
Well, some of that, I suppose, I've covered just now, but I add a bit more to it because they were often being creative rather than simply nostalgic. I mean, nostalgic, again, like romantic, I think the buildings are less like that in reality than is sometimes said. But the one very interesting building, and I think it actually appears in one in Inez Bitt's stories, actually, is Lynn Castle. Now, Margot Asquith had three brothers. To her annoyance, the brothers inherited the huge fortune made by their father, Sir Charles Tennant, for dried bleach in Glasgow, and they spent it very quickly on expensive houses. And in all cases, they were existing houses that were remodeled. So Jack Tennant asks Lutyens to remodel his house that then became called Great Maytham Hall. It looks like a new Edwardian house. It isn't, it's a remodeled old one. You can see at the edges, funnily enough, at the narrow ends of the house, you can see the old bits peeping out. And his brother Frank nearby restores Lynn Castle. And what is very striking about this, now they've come from where the family house was called the Glen. It was in the Borders. It was David Bryce house. That's the kind of architecture that they all said they liked. They, at Lynn Castle, what Frank Tennant does with the architect Robert Lorimer, who'd worked on the family home in Scotland, he builds a kind of castle that is a mixture of Scottish and English. It has the stonework of the old medieval part with its round tower again and the Edwardian part. It kind of merges together, but what makes it stand out is the fact that it has a red tiled roof. Now, English castles don't by and large have red tiled roofs. A building in Scotland, however, of course, very likely to have a red pantiled roof. This is something in between. So their flat tiles, they're bright red. And I think that there might have been a suggestion there of a kind of British castle, a castle that was simultaneously English and Scottish. There are other buildings that are doing something like this. There is a house by Egay Dauber outside Godalming. Today it's a convent. And on one side, on the garden side, it's clearly English Tudor in style, but on the entrance side, on the northern side, it's a mixture of Scottish and French of the same kind of periods, the 17th century mixture of Scottish. So it's providing a sort of alternative history. It's as if the 18th century, as if the wars of the civil war of the 17th century had never happened, as if the Stuarts had never gone away, as if the Hanoverians had never arrived, as if everything had worked out differently from 1625 onwards, and created an idealized version of an architecture which might have mixed French and Scottish and English together. So there's a great deal of imagination, I think, in those areas.
Mm. Thank you. We've got a few more minutes. I'm going to turn to Ailsa Boyd, who has more of a kind of practical question. She said, how much of these sort of conversions and expansions were to do with modern convenience, hidden perhaps, heating, electricity, etc.? Or was this not a priority as they still had lots of servants?
There's an enormous amount of interest in precisely this. I was saying earlier on how the Edwardians had virtually worked out how to plan a house by the time you get to the First World War. The Gidea Park catalogue gives a detailed description of every single one of its 120 or so little houses. And you see a lot of developments in that, which are designs for servantless housing. You see other things like bike stores integrated into the house, for example, what we would now call lifestyle design of one kind or another. Gidea Park has got a modern kitchen and scullery arrangement as opposed to a living kitchen and then a back place for the other bit. So this is all changing very fast, not only at the big scale and at the small scale. What it does at the big scale in the big houses, Lynn Castle is a very good example, Kingsgate to some extent, is that all the stuff that you need to run a big Edwardian household can make for a very picturesque kind of house. There is a house by Thomas Colcott, the architect of the Savoy Hotel, built for himself up in Totteridge. And this is one of these houses that looks as if it was put together at different times, when in fact it was all designed at once. And what he's done on the kitchen side is put an irregular wing on it at a slight angle, which was no practical reason to do. But what he did was he exploited the fact that service wings had a combination of little rooms of different sizes and so on in order to build a knowingly picturesque addition that looks as if it might have been either there before the main part of the house was built or added afterwards. But in fact, it was all conceived at once. So they were enjoying it and they were making the most of it. And this is true of the large houses as it is true of the very smallest houses.
Just a question from Judith Teasdale, and I think the answer is yes. He said, did you research how clients for these houses chose their architects? You spoke of design decisions as though they were the choices made specifically by the architects, but the clients must have had a say and might have driven the sometimes eclectic mixes of styles in interventions.
Yes, Judith, that's absolutely right. And this is why I think the country life is so significant. Yeah, I'm an architect and I've been reading the Architectural Review since I was at school. And we tend, as architecture historians, well, you tend to think that what is going on in architecture is going to appear first in the professional press. The reason why country life is so distinct is that it's talking directly to the clients. It's not talking directly to the architects. And that means it can do a lot of things that, for example, the Architectural Review, which appeared at the same time as Country Life at the start, that they can't do. The editors of the Architectural Review, they may have had their own interests, and sometimes they did grind their own axes, but essentially they had to publish the stuff that they were sent. And when they ran out of stuff that they were sent, the editors, who are luckily a very talented group of people, publish their own houses sometimes more than once. That's what they're doing. Now, the Country Life, on the other hand, publishes what Tipping, first of all, and later Weaver want to publish. So it takes a very wide range of interests, from historic buildings to new buildings, and they do it precisely as they want, and they can focus on the subjects that interest them. Now, I think it's quite likely that Lord Avebury found Romaine Walker through Country Life, because just before he invites Romaine Walker to come and work on Kingsgate Castle for him, Country Life had done a large, I think two or possibly even 3 week article about buildings designed by Romaine Walker for Robert Hudson, his great client, another person who became rich by inventing a dry version of something that hadn't been dry before, dry soap, I suppose, a bit like Lux powder or something. And the and what Country Life had focused on in these articles was the extreme modern efficiency of the estate buildings that Romaine Walker had designed. Now, these were buildings that were very picturesque and Tudor in appearance, but inside they were beautifully planned and they had the latest machinery. And what Country Life could say, and the Architectural Review never thought of saying this as far as I know, is that there isn't a conflict between these Tudor buildings and the modern machinery, because the Tudor buildings are made up from modular pieces of timber. They're slotted together in a regular and efficient way. They seem to them to be all part of the same story. Now, it's much more likely that Lord Avebury found Remaine Walker by reading Country Life, and it would have appealed enormously to a logical, rational person like Avebury to read about the success of these estate buildings. That would have interested him. Whereas it's very unlikely, I think, having read Avery's biography, that he would have been that interested in the various style wars that occupied the professional press at the time. So the short answer is Country Life, I think.
Thank you, lovely. Well, I'm afraid we're gonna have to wrap things up just because it's just after 2 o'clock. And it just remains for me to thank Tim for a scintillating talk and providing this overview and a bit of the subject. And of course, his book, which I hope you'll all delve into or even purchase. Somebody asked, thank you, Tim, is there a way to purchase a signed copy of your book?
That's a very kind. I mean, let me say, I've seen your kind comments everywhere in the chat. And it's a pleasure to see them and to see them all. Someone also asked about Standen, if I may just say, yes, that also is a mixture house, exactly like one of these. I'd be delighted to hear from anyone. If anyone would like me to sign their copy of their book, I'd be more than happy. You can find me on the Cambridge University website. We'll give you my email address. Always delighted to hear from anyone, not just on this subject, but on a previous project that was supported by the Paul Mellon Centre, which Martin kindly mentioned at the start, which is vicarages, parsonages, 19th century ones. I just can't hear enough about any of these subjects. I'm always delighted to hear from anyone on any of this. Please do put any questions directly to me.
Thank you so much, Tim. That's very kind of you. We've got a lively programme of events over the next months, details of which you'll find on our website. And I want to draw your attention to the 6-part public lecture course beginning on the 7th of April, Britain and the World in the Middle Ages, Images and Reality. That takes place in our lecture room and it's live streamed. And our book launch at 6 p.m. on the 26th of April, Pevsner Architectural Guides, Birmingham and the Black Country. This is hot off the press. And that takes the form of a Zoom webinar, and I'm sure we'll see lots of you then. So from all of us here, Tim, Steph, and me, goodbye and enjoy the rest of your day. Thank you very much.